When analyzing an argument, it is important to recognize the information that you do not know. When analyzing an argument, there's going to be a little bit of information that you do know and a lot of information that you do not know. So it is important to recognize and acknowledge missing links and disconnected information. So let me give you an example of that. Lauren wants to be more productive. Last week, she began getting up earlier. So in a casual conversation, this argument makes perfect sense. Lauren wants to be more productive. So to become more productive, last week, she started getting up earlier because it's a common held belief that if you get up earlier, that you'll get more done. And that's true for a lot of people. So that makes sense in a casual conversation. But if you're actually trying to analyze this argument, this does not make sense because there's a disconnect. Remember, you need to acknowledge a missing links and disconnected information. These, when it comes down to it, these two sentences are disconnected. There's no link between them. Lauren wants to be more productive is one thought. And the other thought is last week she began getting up earlier. Now, of course, we know that the author or the writer is implying that she started getting up earlier to be more productive. But we really don't know that because it's never stated. So we can't just assume information. We can't just make up links between unrelated concepts unless the writer tells us that we can relate those two concepts to each other. So I'm going to draw a circle here. And everything inside the circle is going to be what we do know. And everything outside the circle is going to be what we don't know. So what do we know? We know Lauren's goal. Lauren's goal is to be more productive. We know that she adjusted wake-up time. And we know when she did it. She adjusted her wake-up time last week. That's all we know. So what are some things that we don't know? We don't know when this new wake-up time is. We just know the wake-up time is earlier, but earlier than what? So this could be 9 a.m. or 3:30 a.m. in the morning. We have no idea. We don't know why she changed the wake-up time. I'll just write why. Is it to be more productive? Maybe she started a new job that requires her to be there early. Maybe she has kids who started getting up earlier. Or maybe the school year started again, so she needs to make sure she's up to get the kids to school on time. We don't know. And another thing we don't know is why does she want to be more productive? That's another why question. Not quite as relevant to what we're talking about, but it's still a valid question. And how does she plan to become more productive? So we can infer here that her plan for being more productive is to get up earlier, but we don't really know that because there's a missing link here. So there's a little bit of information in here that we do know. This is very limited. Information out here is stuff we don't know. These are just some basic things that we don't know. But really, I could fill up this whole whiteboard and hundreds of other whiteboards with things that we don't know. This circle, the info in the circle is never going to get any bigger from these two sentences. But really, there's tons of information we don't know. So remember, when analyzing an argument, you need to remember a little bit of information you do know, a lot that you don't know. So although some assumptions may be fairly reasonable given the information, it is important to understand that they are just assumptions and not, in fact, known. When looking at a passage, it's good to determine the author's main point and their purpose. So another term for main point would be main idea. So basically, this is what the author is trying to convey. It's the most important information that the author is trying to convey to the reader. Then there's purpose. This is why the author is trying to convey the information. So we could say that the main point is the what, and the purpose is the why. Because the purpose is what the author is hoping to achieve by sharing the information with you. So purpose is the why behind the what. Purpose is the reason you're sharing the what. So an example of this would be that an author's main point could be that yellow lights should be longer. And their premises for that, or what backs up their belief about that, is that longer yellow lights will save lives through reduced traffic accidents. So the purpose here, the reason that the author would share this main point with you and the evidence behind it, is to make you also believe that yellow lights should be longer. So that's just an elementary example of that. So we have a passage right here, and we're not going to look for the purpose in this main passage. We're just going to look at the author's main point. So this says, people need to appreciate public schools. The school year should be increased by 2 weeks. This would allow for increased instruction in core subject areas. This would also shorten the summer break, which would lessen the amount of time for students to forget what they learned. So, this first sentence here says, people need to appreciate public schools. So, could that be a conclusion or a main point? Another word for main point is a conclusion. So we have main point, and then I'll put in parentheses here, conclusion. And then we have premises that back up a main point. This is basically kind of the evidence or the reasons behind that main point. So, could this be a main point? Yes, but let's keep moving on and see if that's really the main point of this passage. The next sentence says, the school year should be increased by 2 weeks. Could that be a main point? Absolutely. Now, remember, a main point needs to have premises, things to back it up, facts, figures, arguments, anything like that to back it up. Okay? So, these next two sentences talk about why it'd be good to increase the school year by 2 weeks. They don't talk about why people need to appreciate public schools more. So these two sentences, these last two sentences are basically premises backing up this sentence right here, saying the school year should be increased by 2 weeks. So this second sentence here is the main point. This first sentence is really a distractor. Now, in kind of a roundabout way, if the school year was increased by 2 weeks, then maybe people would begin to appreciate public schools more and begin to appreciate all that they're teaching children. But that's kind of a roundabout way, and these two premises right here relate more directly to this sentence here than they do this first sentence. So premises can be thought of as the foundations or the building blocks for the main point. Without premises, a main point crumbles because there's nothing to back it up. So you have to have those premises. So that's a look at author's main point or purpose. We have two different viewpoints up here. So this first sentence, or this first viewpoint, says the best way to understand the meaning of a new word is to look it up in the dictionary. And the second sentence says the meaning of an unfamiliar word can be understood by looking at any prefixes, suffixes, and the root word itself. So both of these viewpoints or approaches talk about finding the definition of an unfamiliar word. They both explain ways to figure out what a word means, but each viewpoint presents a different way to find the definition. So the first viewpoint takes the stance that a person needs to use another book, the dictionary, to find the meaning of the word. So here, we need a dictionary. But then the second viewpoint states that a person can understand a word just by looking at the parts of a word. So the first viewpoint says that the person needs to use some outside source to figure out the meaning of a word. In other words, they're incapable of figuring out the definition of the word on their own. Whereas the second viewpoint says that a person, by looking at the word, can determine by themselves what the word means. So neither of these approaches is necessarily wrong, they're just different. So when you have two viewpoints, it's important to compare them to each other to see which one is the best.
Character analysis. When analyzing a character, you should look at the character's physical traits, thoughts, feelings, and attitudes, and motivations. A character's physical traits could include their eye and hair color, their height or weight, or their clothing. These are just a few examples. You could think of a lot more things to physically describe that character, but their physical traits are important when you're analyzing the character. Something else to look at are the character's thoughts, feelings, and attitudes. And this is the character's ideas about a certain topic or ideas about a certain character. So whenever you're reading, if you know that a character really doesn't like another character, then you may start to feel the same way, or you might have to ask yourself why that character feels that way in the first place. Or if a character really hates school, for instance, if it's a child it's a story that's written from a child's point of view, so you're hearing that a child's ideas about school are that school is real bad, they don't like going, then you may have to investigate why they feel that way about it. But the character's thoughts, feelings, and attitudes are going to be important to you understanding that character as a whole. The last thing you want to look at are a character's motivations. And their motivations are their reasons for behaving a certain way. So that's kind of what we talked about up here. Once you know the character's ideas or feelings about a certain topic or character, you want to find out the reasons for that or the reasons for how for why they are behaving in a certain way. And an example we're going to look at is a mystery novel. Your main character in a mystery novel may be a detective. That detective may pretend to be a doctor to find out certain information from a suspect because he wants to know if that suspect is guilty or not. So knowing the motivation for that main character to be deceitful, to lie about his profession, you know that he's doing that to find out the truth from this suspect. He's not doing it just because he's trying to be deceitful or he's a bad person. He's doing it because his job is a detective, and as a detective, he sometimes has to be a little sneaky to find out the answers he wants to know. So whenever you are analyzing a character, make sure you focus on checking out their character traits, their physical character traits, their thoughts, feelings, and attitudes toward certain topics and certain characters, and their motivations or reasons for doing certain things.
Many times readers come across words that they are unfamiliar with, so it's important that readers understand how to determine the definition of a word based on its context. This means looking at the words around it and how the word is used in the sentence. Let's look at a couple of examples. This first example says, the elderly scholar spent his evenings hunched over arcane text that few other people even knew existed. So the unfamiliar word here is arcane, but you will see that you can pretty much determine the definition of that word based on the words around it. Here we see the word elderly coming before scholar. So if only an elderly scholar would be studying these texts, then it means that it must be some kind of complex subject that only someone who has acquired much knowledge and wisdom would understand. And then we also see that it says that few other people even knew existed. So that means it's something rare or something that only a few people would know about. So here we have easily and quickly determined the definition of arcane. This next sentence says, Ron's fealty to his parents was not shared by Karen, who disobeyed their every command. Now you'll notice here that there's not very many words that tell us the definition of fealty. Instead, we see words that tell us what fealty is not. Because here it says, Karen, who disobeyed their every command. Here, Ron is being contrasted with Karen. So if fealty is not disobeying their every command, then fealty must mean obeying or being faithful to. Because notice here we're seeing that Karen disobeys their every command, but Ron does not. So Ron must mean not disobeying. In other words, it means obeying. So you see here how by looking at context clues, a reader can quickly determine the definition of a word. And although it may not be the exact definition, it generally will be the definition for that word in that particular sentence. And so this can be very helpful because it helps a reader be more efficient, because determining the definition of a word based on context is much quicker than consulting a dictionary or a thesaurus.
Inference. Inferences are conclusions that a reader makes using clues in the text. So an author may not explicitly say something, but they leave little hints behind, and you have to connect the dots to form a conclusion. And inference is different than making a guess, because it is based on evidence. So you read, you pick up on those clues or hints that the author leaves behind, and you put them all together to form your inference. So let's look at a couple of examples. Charlotte's toddler is in bed asleep upstairs. She hears a loud thump and then loud crying. So knowing that the toddler is in bed asleep and then hearing a thump and crying, you can infer, or Charlotte can infer when she's at home, that her toddler fell out of bed. Now, our example doesn't say the toddler fell out of bed, and it doesn't say Charlotte ran upstairs and found her child on the floor. But because you know the kid was in a bed sleeping, and then you hear a thump, probably against the floor, and then crying because the kid is hurt or scared from waking up in the middle of the night on the floor unexpectedly, Charlotte can infer that her toddler fell out of bed. Or the reader can infer that that's what happened whenever they're trying to process the story and figure out what the author was trying to tell them with these clues. So let's look at another example. Nolan sees cookie crumbs on the floor and chocolate around his son's mouth. So cookie crumbs on the floor, chocolate around his mouth is going to tell you that Nolan's son got into the cookie jar. And it may not be the cookie jar, it may be that he got into a pack of cookies, but you don't really know the rest of that. You just know that if there are cookie crumbs on the floor and chocolate around his son's mouth, that the kid got into cookies somehow. So you can infer he got into a cookie jar or a pack of cookies without the author explicitly saying that to you. And that's all it is. That's all inference is. Reading something and coming to a conclusion. A lot of the times, it's really obvious things. If you see a lady come into a store, and she's dripping wet, and it's raining outside, you can infer that she doesn't have an umbrella. So some things are just common sense. They come to you. You don't even realize you're making an inference. But in the end, an inference is just a conclusion that a reader makes based on evidence. Interpretation of expository or literary text. Well, to determine what your interpretation of a work is going to be, first, let's refresh ourselves on what expository and literary text are. Expository writing is going to be something that informs, explains, or describes. It's going to be very cut and dry. There's not a plot. It's basically there to explain something to you, tell you how to do something, give instructions. A science research paper would be an example. Baking instructions for baking a cake. Anything like that would be expository. So what you want to do is outline the basic elements of that paper, and then you want to evaluate their effectiveness. This is how you are going to give your interpretation. Once you outline the basic elements of the research paper or the recipe, then you can evaluate their effectiveness. Did you learn what you were supposed to learn from the research paper? Are you now able to bake a cake following those directions? Very cut and dry. Literary is a little bit different. Literary works are going to be your narratives, essays, works of fiction. These are going to have a plot. There's going to be more that you will have to go through. And because there will be so much more to the literary works, you want to focus on just one aspect to give your interpretation. You don't want to try to cover all of the elements because that would be too much and you wouldn't really get to put your personal interpretation on all of the different aspects of that work. So, some aspects you could choose from are the topic of the story, major characters in the story, major events, the setting, structure, point of view, use of language, or tone. Any of these would work. Pick one, focus on that one, and what you're going to do is explained here. An interpretation should both describe the text and elaborate upon it. So, say we were to choose major characters. You would want to describe what's in the text and elaborate upon it. And I've put that into a few steps here for you. So, to describe the text, introduce the major characters. In your interpretation, describe the major characters. What do they look like? What are their attitudes? How has the author described them in the text? Then, explain how the author portrays them. Are they liked by other characters? Are they meant to be a villain or a hero? Are they just an everyday Joe? How does the author portray these characters? And then discuss what the author's purpose was. Why did the author portray them that way? What did the author want to get across to readers? And because this is an interpretation, there are going to be several different answers. There's no one right answer, because no one is going to know exactly what the author's purpose was. You're giving your interpretation, what you think the author meant. So you'll describe everything that the author put in the book about the characters, and then you'll elaborate upon what the author put in there by telling what you think the author was trying to tell, what the author's theme was, what their purpose was for showing characters in a certain light. So when you are interpreting a text with the expository, you want to remember to just outline the basic elements and evaluate their effectiveness. Were you able to bake that cake? Did you learn what you were supposed to from the research paper? With literary works, you want to focus on one aspect out of all the different things you could focus on in a literary text. Pick one, just one, and then describe that one from the text, what the author actually said, and elaborate upon it. Go through and give your opinion on it, what you think the author meant. And the thing is, it's an interpretation. Everyone's is going to be a little different. Not everyone's going to pick the same aspect to focus on, and not everyone's going to elaborate upon it the same way. So since the author knew he was writing to lots of different readers whenever he or she created this work, try to make your interpretation unique. Interpretive essays. When you're writing an interpretive essay, you definitely want to identify the author's methods. What tone did the author use? What were the major characters? What was the main event, the plot of the story? Where was the setting? All of those things are important, but it's not the only thing you want to do. This is only step one. Step two is evaluate and analyze the author's methods. If you only identify them, you're only going so far. To have an effective interpretive essay, you want to evaluate the methods the author used instead of simply identifying them. Now, one thing to keep in mind when you're doing this is that there's a certain ambiguity in most literary works, which is the presence of multiple, somewhat inconsistent truths in a literary work. So when you're evaluating, you may say, oh, there was this good guy, but he made a bad decision. He did a bad thing. So you have to maybe come to a judgment on that person. Did you think that they were a good person or a bad person? Were they bad because of the bad thing they did? Or was it forgivable because overall they were a good person? There's a lot of ambiguity, a lot of questions that come up in great literary works. And that's because great literary works attempt to show life in all of its messy reality. And it's true, life is messy. Nothing is as cut and dry as it seems. You may see someone steal a loaf of bread and some peanut butter, but if they're doing it because they're bringing it home to their five small children because they've been laid off, then it's harder to judge them for stealing the bread and peanut butter. So keep in mind ambiguity whenever you're coming up with your interpretation of literary works. A lot of literary works are going to pose more questions than answers. And that's good. They make you think. They don't just tell you the answers. You're left wondering, I wonder what the author meant by that. Or was it really bad of this person to do that? Or was it okay because of the situation? How do I feel about that? Works that make you ask yourself questions like that tend to be the great literary works. So whenever you are writing your interpretive essay, you want to respond to the likely questions of readers. If it's a question you had, then it's likely that other readers have the same question, and they'll be interested in your essay because it's going to answer or give a possible answer to one of the same questions that they had. Now, one of the best ways to make your interpretive essay effective is to let other people read your early drafts. Now, this may be hard, especially if you're a shy or self-conscious writer, but you're hopefully showing your writing to someone that you trust, someone that's going to give you, if not always positive, but at least helpful criticism. So one thing you should do is work their questions in. If they ask you, well, why did you say this? Or, I really thought the character seemed this way, how did you get to this idea? Work those questions in, because if your early readers are having those questions, your same readers reading the final draft are going to have those kinds of questions. Does your argument hold up? If you argued that someone was a good person despite the bad thing they did, you have to make sure you put enough defense in there for your argument to hold up. Is the thesis statement effective? If you put in a thesis statement about honesty being the best policy always, then it's going to be hard for you to write about how sometimes it's all right to bend the rules. So you need to make sure that your interpretation is going to support your thesis statement. Or you may need to rewrite the thesis statement if you find that the rest of your paper doesn't support your original one. Now, this is one of the hard ones. Don't get defensive. If your readers are telling you things that you need to fix or change or that they don't like, you might be apt to get defensive. But remember, they're people you trust, they're your friends, and they're telling you these things to help you, not to be mean. Now, another way to help yourself not be defensive and maybe edit your own paper is to try to view it as a reader. Try to be detached and not view your paper as the author, but as a reader, someone reading something that they found in the newspaper, not necessarily something that you wrote. And then it may be easier for you to be objective about what you need to change. And the last but very important step here is to remember that early drafts are meant to be improved upon. It's a draft for a reason. No one's going to write a perfect paper the first time they write something down. There's going to be something they can add to make it better. There's going to be some grammatical error they need to fix. So remember, it's a draft. It's meant to be drafted more times, edited, added to, until you get that final copy that you are really proud of. So remember, when you're writing an interpretive essay, to first identify the author's methods, but most importantly, go back and evaluate those methods and come up with your own interpretation of the text. And because you're interpreting it one way, you have to remember that there is ambiguity and other people may interpret things other ways. So make sure that you are responding to some likely questions, but you're leaving room for other answers whenever you're coming up with your interpretation. multiple meaning words. Some words are spelled exactly the same, but they have different meanings in different contexts. So you have to look at context clues to figure out which version of the word you have in your sentence. One way you can do that is by looking to see if the word is a noun or a verb. The grammatical category that the word is can determine what the word means. And vice versa. If you aren't sure of the pronunciation, but you know which version of the word is being used, you can figure out what the part of speech is. So let's look at our first example. Trip. Trip can be a vacation, which is a noun, or it can mean to fall over something, which is a verb. So when we look at our sentences, she took a trip to Colorado. If you aren't careful, you might trip over that step. In this sentence, she took a trip to Colorado. She's taking a vacation. So you know this is a noun. Alternately, you could say, oh, a trip is a thing you might take, so it's a noun, so it has to mean vacation. If you aren't careful, you might trip over that step. This one is being used as a verb, so you know it means you might fall over that step. Alternately, you could say, you might trip over that step. Oh, in this sentence, trip is something you're doing, so it has to be a verb in this sentence. So either way, finding out if it's a noun or a verb can help you figure out which version of the word you're using in that sentence. Let's look at another example. Degree. Degree has at least three different meanings, and this one's a little trickier because they are all nouns. Unit of temperature is a noun. A title earned at graduation, if you earn a degree in astrophysics, that is a noun. Or the amount or extent of something is a noun. So finding the part of speech won't help you determine meaning with this particular example, but reading the sentence and using context clues can help you figure out which one we're talking about. He didn't notice when the temperature rose 1 degree. Okay, and this one, he didn't notice when the temperature rose 1 degree. You can look at temperature to know that this one is talking about a unit of temperature. So you're using your context clues to figure out the meaning of this word. Our next one, the business is only hiring someone with a degree. So are they hiring someone with a unit of temperature? Everyone has a temperature of something. Are they hiring only people that have earned a title through graduating? Or are they only hiring people with an amount or extent? And that one didn't really go any further, so it wouldn't be the amount or extent of something. So this one, if you sub in their title earned at graduation, this business is only hiring someone who is graduated. This one is gonna have to do more with title at graduation. And then our last example, it was hard to tell the degree to which he really cared about the outcome. And this one, was it hard to tell the temperature to which he cared about the outcome, the title earned at graduation, or the amount or extent to which he really cared? And in this one, it's the amount or extent to which he cared. Maybe he didn't care that much about this, and so it was hard to tell, or maybe he was keeping his emotions inside, and so it was still hard to tell the degree to which he cared. So whenever you're finding words that could mean more than one thing, our special multiple meaning words, you want to look and see the context around the word. Look at the whole sentence to see what would make sense. And if you know multiple meanings of a word, try each definition that you know to see which one makes sense so you're understanding the sentence correctly. Those multiple meaning words can be tricky. Point of view. The point of view is the perspective from which a story is told, and the narrator is the person who tells the story. So when we're looking for point of view, we're looking to see if we have a first-person narrator or a third-person narrator that's telling us the story. In first-person, your narrator is going to be your main character, And they're going to be saying I, me, we. These are the pronouns you're going to see associated with the first person narrator. If it's the main character, you're only going to get to know what the main character knows. You're only going to get to read about what that main character does or what he does with someone else. But you won't know about anything that doesn't happen involving the main character because this is written from a first person point of view and you're only going to hear from this viewpoint. Third person is the most common point of view. And you're going to see pronouns like he, she, and they. The narrator is going to talk about other characters, but the narrator is not one of the characters. And third person omniscient is very common as well. Omniscient means all-knowing. So a third person omniscient narrator is going to be one who describes all other characters. So this narrator is going to be able to tell you what every other character in the story is thinking, what every other character in the story is doing. Now, they may not actually do it all in the same passage. Sometimes they split it into chapters. So one chapter is written to where the author is telling you everything that Johnny does. One chapter is split to tell you everything that Susie does. So you find out everyone's point of view, but possibly at different times. But the author is able to do all that without actually being a part of the story. So whenever you're looking for who your narrator is, the pronouns are the important thing to look at. Let's look at this passage. John walked to school every day. He and his friends were often cold and tired by the time they arrived. They were allowed to warm up by the stove before sitting in their seats. In this passage, let's look at the pronouns to help determine the point of view. And your pronouns are going to be words that take the place of nouns, such as I, me, we, he, she, they, it, you. But these are going to be the ones that are really going to set you off as markers to let you know if it's a first person or third person narrator that you're listening to. So looking through this, we have he and his friends. By the time they arrived, they were allowed to warm up by the stove before sitting in their seats. And it started with John. So the narrator is using he and they and someone's name. Now, first person could use someone's name, and that's why it's important to look at the pronouns. But the narrator starts talking about John, and then he uses all of these third person pronouns. The narrator is a third person narrator here. Let's write it out. Third person. And you know this because you're looking at the pronouns. And the pronouns are all telling you that the narrator is telling you what's happening, but the narrator is not a part of the action. So the point of view is a third person point of view. So whenever you're going to find point of view, you want to know this because the perspective of the story, who it's coming from, is important. If it's coming from a certain character, or if it's coming from a first person or a third person point of view, then you're going to have a different plot or have information, more intimate information in first person and a greater variety of information with third person. So it's always important to determine your point of view whenever you are reading a story. So just keep in mind that the best way to find that is by looking at the pronouns. I, me, and we, he, she, and they. Textual evidence for predictions. A prediction is an educated guess about what will come later in a text. Now, your predictions can be about an event or about how a character will behave. But any prediction you make must be based on information in the text or based on knowledge about literature in general. For instance, if you've seen how a character has acted in a story so far, you can make a prediction about his future actions. And with your knowledge about literature, you know the basic layout of a mystery novel, so you might be able to predict who did something in a story or how the story is going to end up based on your general knowledge of literature. And the more you read, the more your general knowledge about literature is going to increase, so you may be able to make more predictions the more you read. Now, one specific way that you might find textual support for prediction is with foreshadowing. And foreshadowing is when the author hints at something that will occur later in the plot. So sometimes it's subtle. Sometimes the author doesn't say exactly what will happen. It may mention storm clouds on the horizon, and the storm clouds could equal danger or something bad happening. So if you have a character who is going through a tough time and then they see storm clouds on the horizon, or someone mentions a storm might be coming, then that may be the author's way of hinting that something bad is coming or danger is approaching. However, sometimes foreshadowing could be more direct, as in Romeo and Juliet. They talk about how they would rather die than live without one another. And that was William Shakespeare's way of hinting that in the end, when they thought that they might live without one another, they did end up killing themselves rather than live without the other one. Sometimes foreshadowing comes in the form of a fortune teller. There are a lot of stories that include a fortune teller, or someone that happens to tell someone's fortune or tell their future, even without being labeled a fortune teller. And they'll say exactly what's going to happen, and then later on, that's how the plot unfolds. Now, sometimes the author will throw in what's called a red herring. And that's when they tell you what's going to happen, but it doesn't really happen. So, when a hint or prediction by the author does not actually happen, so you have to pay attention, because sometimes the author may give you a direct foreshadowing example. They may go and say exactly what's going to happen, and that'll be true. But sometimes they'll give a really big hint, or they'll even lay out the prediction with the fortune teller or by the characters just discussing how they feel like things are going to end up. But it's a red herring, because that's not really how the author ends the story. So don't always think that if the author tells you something's going to happen, it's going to happen. But foreshadowing can often be a good textual support for any predictions you're going to make. So whenever you are making predictions while you're reading a story, make sure that your predictions are based on evidence either from the story itself, information in that text, or information that you've gained from reading other books and getting a general knowledge about literature. Textual support for interpretation. Whenever you're going to interpret a work, you are going to identify the author's methods, their tone, their use of language, their plot, major characters, setting. Then you're going to decide on one of those aspects of the writing, pick just one, and evaluate and analyze that one aspect. You want to give your opinion on what the author was trying to do with the use of this character or with the use of a certain tone. What was their purpose in doing that? But you want to make it stronger. And one way that you can make your evaluation, your interpretation of this work stronger, is to root your interpretation in the text. That means you go through and you find specific examples in the text that support what your interpretation is. The examples from the text support your ideas. So it doesn't look like it's just things that you're coming up with out of your head. It's things that you came up with because of something specific in the story that made you think. So one thing you can look at is quotes. Look at what characters say. This could be something that affects the tone, or it could be something that reflects on a character, or it could be something specific letting you know what's happening in the plot. Look at details from the story. It could be how someone looks, so physical characteristics. It could be specific things that happen in the plot. It could have to do with the tone as well. It could have to do with specific language that the author used. But find those details and then put them into your evaluation. Find these quotes and put them into your interpretation. So if you're trying to describe how a character acts or how you felt about a character, go back and find something specific about that character in the story and put it into your interpretation so that your essay now has roots in the text and is going to be stronger. Another thing you can do, which isn't going to pull information directly from the text you read, but is going to make your work stronger, is to find statistics or facts relating to your topic. Now, this could be if you're writing about cell phones, you might say a lot of people use cell phones. Well, instead of using that general phrase, you could give an actual number of people who use cell phones. Or if it's people using cell phones while driving, or while at home, or while at work, or under or over a certain age, you could look up that statistic and put it into your paper. And it's going to help because it makes things more precise. It shows you did your research. It shows you aren't just making things up from your head. You are actually going out and finding this information somewhere. The same way that you giving your opinion of a character or of the theme of a work is based on the quotes that you find or details that you find in the writing. So whenever you are giving an interpretive essay, you want to find textual support for that interpretation. Identifying the author's methods, finding one aspect to focus on, and evaluating and analyzing that is all important, but to make it even stronger, you want to root your interpretation in the text. Validity, reliability, and relevance of primary and secondary sources. Research papers depend on information taken from primary and secondary sources, and it's important that that information be valid, reliable, and relevant. So let's talk about sources. Primary sources are derived directly from the topic with no intermediation. Some examples would be diaries, eyewitness accounts, videos, letters, legislative documents, and experimental data. All of these things are first-hand accounts or evidence of what happened, and they're derived directly from the topic. There's nothing between that source and what you're reading. Secondary sources, on the other hand, are going to be commentaries or interpretations of primary sources. They're secondary. They take one of these things and then they comment on it or interpret it. So examples would be books and articles of history and literary criticism. If you have books or articles that are written about history, or you've got a literary criticism, something criticizing some other work of literature, they are commenting or interpreting a primary source, which makes it a secondary source. And they can still be sources that are good for your research paper, but you have to make sure that they fit these criteria. Your sources need to be valid, reliable, and relevant. You may find an amazing source. You may find a diary that you think is so cool and you want to include it in your paper, but if it's not valid, reliable, and relevant, then you shouldn't use that source. So let's talk about what each one of these means. Validity is indicated by the extent to which it is confirmed and echoed in other works. So a source could be valid if it's confirmed and echoed in other works. That means other works on the same topic that you're working on have cited that source. So if you're using something and you look it up and you see that it's been cited in lots of other papers, then that means that it's a pretty valid source, and that would be a good one to use. So you could check off validity. Next, you need to look at reliability. How reliable is your source? And that means that the source must consistently support your point to be reliable. If you have a topic and your source supports the topic and then gives a counter argument and goes back and forth and compares and contrasts why your idea or your topic is good or bad, that's not reliable. You want it to consistently support your point. You don't want it to waver back and forth. You don't want it to give any other option. You only want it to support your point if you're going to use it as a source. Now, in your writing, you can definitely go back and forth on a point, but if you're using a source in your research paper, it needs to be reliable. It needs to only back up your point and not give any other options. So if that happens, you can say, okay, it's reliable. I can use this source. Now let's look at relevance. In order to be able to use it, it's got to be valid, reliable, and relevant. So we've got to make sure it's relevant. And relevance refers to the extent to which the source applies to your essay. So if you're writing an essay about World War II and you find an amazing diary that was written by a slave during Civil War times, you shouldn't use it because it isn't relevant. It doesn't apply to your essay. It may be a really awesome book that you read, or whatever format the diary was in. You may think, this is so amazing, I want to use it in something, but you can't use it in your current work about World War II because it isn't fit in. It's not relevant. It doesn't apply to your essay. Even though they may both refer to war times, it's not referring to the correct war. So you have to make sure that your paper is going to only reflect sources that are relevant. So if you find a source and you can check that it's been used in other sources, it's valid, that it consistently supports your point, it's reliable, and that it applies to something in your essay, so it's relevant, then you can use that source. Otherwise, you should probably look for better sources and leave any that don't fit any one of these criteria behind and try not to use them. If you find something and you think, oh, it's reliable, it constantly is supporting my point, ooh, it's relevant, it definitely has to do with my paper, but it isn't valid, you can't find it cited anywhere else, you might not want to use that source because it may not be a valid source. It could be something that someone wrote without any information to back it up. It could just be something they wrote on the internet and you found it and it worked for your paper, but if it's not valid, it's not going to be a good source. So, when writing research papers, make sure that you are finding sources, both primary and secondary, that are valid, reliable, and relevant.
This is an ACT video for reading, particularly for comprehension. Readers must always be conscious of the difference between a fact and an opinion. So first we need to define what a fact and what an opinion is. So a fact can be proved or disproved. In other words, a fact can be subjected to analysis. However, an opinion cannot be subjected to an analysis. An opinion may not be alterable by research, because an opinion is just the author's personal feelings. So this sentence right here says, the distance from New York to Boston is about 200 miles. So this right here is a fact, because this can be proven or disproven. Now, although this isn't very specific because it uses the word about, it still is a fact. You could look at a map and see that the distance from New York to Boston is about 200 miles. Now, the sentence, New York is too crowded, is stated almost like a fact, but it is still an opinion because there is no objective way to measure overcrowding. And so many times an opinion will be indicated by words like believe, think, or feel. Now, in this case, New York is too crowded. We don't see any of those words, so it's stated like a fact. But you have to, as a reader, have to evaluate the sentence and realize that this cannot be proved or disproved. You have to realize that it's just the author's personal feelings. Now, many times, an opinion will be supported by facts. So an example would be the author gives the population density of New York as a reason for why it is overcrowded. And now an opinion supported by facts tends to be more convincing. However, that doesn't make it a fact, even though the writer might back it up with a fact. It's still an opinion. It's still the author's personal feelings. Now, like I said, an opinion supported by a fact tends to be more convincing. But when authors support their opinions with other opinions, the reader is unlikely to be moved. When someone infers something, it means they form a conclusion about something the author has not actually stated by making logical deductions from things he has stated. So, if you were to just read the first part of this definition, you might think that an inference is a guess, because the first part of this definition says forming a conclusion about something the author has not actually stated. So while that is what an inference is, you also base an inference on things the author has stated. So it's not just something that you're making up. You're basing it on logical reasoning, or you're coming to this conclusion from logical deductions. Basically, you're reading in between the lines. Now, infer is closely related to the word imply. Imply and infer are flip sides of the same coin. An author implies something by suggesting it without saying it directly. And then a reader infers what the author is trying to imply. So this passage up here says, the saying that job applicants should dress for success is not far from the truth. An interviewer's first impression of a job candidate will be based on what they see. The interviewer will most likely process a resume in light of that first impression. The nicer someone dresses, the more serious they probably are about a job. So, after you read this passage, you're now faced with a question. The author would most likely agree that. And then you have several options here. So, there will be many times when you have to read a passage and then answer a question about it. And so, a lot of times the question will be something like, the author would most likely agree that, or the researchers would most likely concur with which one of the following, or the argument most strongly supports which one of the following, or which one of the following can be properly inferred from the passage above. Any of those are all relating to the same core question. What can you infer from this passage? So A says women do better than men in interviews. So we have to make a distinction here between things that are true and things that can be backed up by the passage we just read. So, women may actually do better than men in interviews. I haven't seen the statistics on it. So just say, for example, that this is true. Women do better than men in interviews. This is still not a correct answer because we're trying to make an inference from this passage up here. And the author never talks about women versus men in interviews. So we cannot go with A. B says interview questions should focus more on achievements than goals. Well, I mean, that makes sense that you should ask a candidate about their past achievements rather than their future goals. But again, there's nothing to back it up, no evidence for that. C says job applicants who dress nicely feel more confident. That sounds good. That's probably true. And that seems to be supported by this, because you think if you dress for success, then you'll be more confident. That may be what this phrase is kind of saying, is that you'll feel more confident if you dress for success. But nothing else in this passage backs up C. Overall, this passage is not about the job applicant feeling more confident. It's more about the impression their dress gives to a potential employer or the interviewer. So we come to D. So pretty much we can already conclude that D is correct by process of elimination. But we don't want to just stop there. We want to go ahead and dive into this and see if D really is the correct answer. So it says, a male job applicant should make sure his tie and shirt match. Now you may be thinking, this passage never talks about matching or ties or shirts, but this is still the correct answer. Because remember, we're talking about making a good first impression. This last sentence says, the nicer someone dresses, the more serious they probably are about a job. So one way to dress nice is to be matching. And you match well, and you look nice, you make a good first impression, and you dress for success. So D is the correct answer. A reader should look for clues to make predictions about what will happen next in a story. It's important for a reader to make predictions because it helps them analyze what they are reading and better understand everything they are reading. And so there's two ways for a reader to make predictions about what they're reading. And so the first way we already identified, and that's through clues in the story. Many times the author includes clues in the story to help the reader figure out what's going to happen next. And the second way to make predictions is through personal experience. Say, for example, that a character stays in the sun all day. Well, from personal experience, you know that if you stay in the sun all day, you get sunburned. So through personal experience, you can make a prediction that the character is going to get sunburned. Now, suppose there is a story about a boy going swimming, and he swims too far out. And suppose the story says that the boy can't get back to shore, and so he starts to yell. And the lifeguard comes out and helps him. But the story stops after the boy goes back in the water again. Well, even though the story doesn't continue, as a reader, you might be able to predict that the boy won't swim out as far this time because he almost drowned when he swam out that far last time. Now, this prediction may not be true, but it is the most likely thing to happen. So let's read this story right here and analyze it. When Glenn is sick, his mother keeps him home from school. He stays in bed all day and takes medicine. Glenn woke up this morning with a sore throat. His head was hot, and he felt achy. So what usually happens when Glenn is sick? His mother keeps him home from school. Well, Glenn woke up this morning with a sore throat, and his head was hot, and he felt achy. We can conclude then that he's sick, because when you're sick, you know that a lot of times you have a sore throat, you feel hot, and your body kind of aches. And so from this, even though we can predict that his mother's going to keep him home from school, and he's going to have to stay in bed all day and take medicine. Now, we don't actually know what happens next, because, see, the story stops right here. But yet, from clues in the story, we can predict what will happen next. Now, there are some other ways to make predictions. You can also use text features to help locate information to make predictions and verify conclusions determined about different text. So you could use keywords as clues. So you could look for keywords here like sick or home, school, things like that to make these predictions. You can also look for bold print words. If any words are in bold, there's none here, but in other stories there may be words in bold, underlined words, or words in italics. And so make sure that you pay attention to those words. And that'll help you make predictions about a text. Noticing an author's position is very vital to understanding a piece of writing, because every writer is going to have a personal bias, or they're going to have a certain position on whatever they're writing about. So the way they portray something in their writing may not be totally accurate. So it's vital that you as a reader understand the author's position so you can better understand their work of writing. So first of all, the author's position is basically their stance on the issue at hand. It's what they believe about the issue they are writing about. So to help you find the author's position, you need to notice several things. Notice each point here starts with the word notice, because to find the author's position, you can't just sit back and have it come to you. You as the reader are going to have to be proactive and notice these things. So first of all, notice personal opinions. So this is basically noticing when someone is interjecting their own thoughts about something instead of actually putting fact in there. Notice bias. This is when someone words a sentence or a paragraph so that they portray something as being good or maybe portray something else as being bad. In other words, they're not giving fact anymore. The way they word something casts something into a negative light or makes something look very good or very positive. Also, notice emotional language. This is when a writer puts their own thoughts into something or their own opinions into something. And then by using strong emotional language, tries to sway the reader over to their thinking. Now remember, again, we're not talking about a persuasive paper, because persuasive papers are always going to have a certain author's position in it, because that's the idea of a persuasive paper, that the author is trying to sway you a certain way. So we're not focusing on persuasive papers, focusing on other kinds of papers when the author really isn't supposed to have a bias, when they're not supposed to have a position on the issue. But nevertheless, they are going to have a position. And so sometimes they'll insert emotional language to try to persuade someone to their thinking. Then also, notice what information is left out. Because when we're talking about personal opinions, bias, and emotional language, these are all things that are going to be added to the paper. This is something an author may add to the paper to insert their bias or to insert their own position. But noticing what is left out is when the author doesn't write something to support their position. This may be some fact that would look bad upon their own position, so they just leave it out. So sometimes it's hard to know what is left out because it's not there. And if you don't know anything else about the topic at hand, you may not know what pertinent information is being left out. But sometimes that can be helpful to understanding the author's position. So the important thing to take away from this is that the author's position is their stance on the issue at hand. And any piece of writing that is out there, the author who wrote it is going to have a position on that subject. So it's up to you as the reader to determine how strong that position is portrayed in the paper. And to notice any time anything is skewed or the facts are twisted a little bit and when the author is trying to persuade you to believe like they do. You, as the reader, should always be drawing conclusions. So I'm going to write that point up here on the board. Always be drawing conclusions. In many cases, the conclusion of a writing will not be stated directly, and you will have to infer it from the information you already know and the information you are gathering from the text. So those situations are very difficult, and it's vital that you are always drawing conclusions because you never know when the right time to draw that conclusion will be. In this case, we're talking about conclusions that are stated directly, and these are much easier to find. However, you don't know where in the paper you're going to find this conclusion that is stated directly. Read this sentence. It is always more comfortable to draw conclusions from information stated within a passage rather than to draw them from mere implications. So when we're talking about drawing them from mere implications, that's called inferring. Now, when you're able to draw conclusions from information stated within a passage, that's talking about when a conclusion is stated directly. So these kinds of passages are pretty easy because the information is going to be stated directly. The important thing here is that you read the entire passage. Even though the conclusion is stated directly, you still have to find it. And sometimes there may be another sentence in the passage that looks like the conclusion, and so you may see that sentence and think, okay, this is the conclusion, I found it. But then right after that sentence, the author will then be offering a rebuttal to that proposed conclusion, shutting it down and giving a counterargument, leading up to the author revealing the best conclusion. So it's important that you read the entire passage so that you can be sure that the conclusion you find is the same one the author intended for you to find. When defining words found in a text, often words have a definition that is more than the dictionary definition. So we can say that words have two definitions, a denotative meaning and a connotative meaning. The denotative meaning is the literal meaning of the word. So basically, if you're wondering what the word meant and it's the denotative meaning, then you could just look up the word in the dictionary and the dictionary definition would describe the meaning of that word. However, the connotative meaning of the word also involves the emotional reaction a word may invoke. It depends on the reader's associations they may make with that word. So it goes further than the denotative meaning. And so denotative meanings are generally used in nonfiction works. Whenever in a nonfiction work, the writer isn't trying to be flowery or use figurative language, so the actual definition of the word is what the word means in that context. However, in fiction works, the connotative meaning of a word also is often meant. So it's important that readers learn to differentiate between when the connotative or denotative word or denotative meaning is being used. And so the reader can usually determine by the context clues whether the author is using the denotative or connotative meaning of a word. When a reader comes across an unfamiliar word, it's important that they know techniques to understanding the word's definition. One way to determine a word's definition is by looking at the prefix and suffix of the word. Although there are many words in the English language, many of those words share a common prefix or suffix. So by understanding the meaning of that prefix or suffix, the reader can then determine the likely meaning of the word. So one way to determine word meaning is structural analysis, and that's by looking at the prefix, the root, and the suffix, all of a word. So take the word unacceptable, for example. Here you have the root word, accept. Because that can be a word in itself. And then here you have the prefix, un, and the suffix, able. The prefix is always going to come before the root word, and the suffix is always going to come after the root word. Now, notice I said the root word is the word that can stand alone. I understand that able can also stand alone and is a word, but in this case, it's a suffix. So if you saw un or able written by themselves, you would see it written like this. That's because the dash represents the word. So here, since un is a prefix, the word comes after the prefix. And here with able, the word comes before able because able is the suffix. So say you didn't understand what unacceptable meant. Well, you could look at able, and you know that means able pretty much. And so you know acceptable must mean able to accept. Well, un, you know, means not so from words like unprofessional, because unprofessional means not professional. It means the opposite of. So you know that un means not acceptable. It's something that's not able to be accepted. So thereby using the prefix and the suffix of the word and knowing the meanings of those, the reader can determine the meaning of the word unacceptable. Now some words like backward don't have both a prefix and a suffix. They just have a suffix. So back is the root word and word is the suffix. So say you didn't know what backward meant, but you knew what the root word meant. You knew what back meant. But you remember the word toward, which also has the same suffix. And you know that means going somewhere. So you could get an idea that this suffix has something to do with direction. So since you see the root word back, you know it means going back to. And so that's another example of how to use the prefix or the suffix to determine the meaning of the word. And some words just have a prefix. This word, for example, has a prefix and a suffix, but no root word. Here, bio is a prefix, and ology is also a suffix. And they share that O. And so you could look at this and think, okay, I don't know what this means, but I know I've seen the word bio before and the word biography. Well, that's a book about someone's life. So bio must mean life. And then what does ology mean? Well, I've heard of archaeology, and so that must mean the study of something because you're studying something. So ology means the study of. So by knowing the prefix and the suffix and what they mean of this word, you can conclude that this word most likely means the study of life. So it's important to understand common prefixes and suffixes so that you can determine the meaning of an unfamiliar word. Every piece of writing should have a logical conclusion, and it's your job as the reader to identify that conclusion, mainly for the purpose of helping you to understand whether you agree with the writer or not. Because you don't want to just read a piece of literature, you want to analyze it. So one step in that process to better understanding it is identifying the conclusion to know whether you agree with the writer or not. So now I want to talk about how to identify that conclusion. So you're going to need to infer a lot, or make an inference. And to infer something just means to take what you already know and combine it with something else to draw a conclusion. So it's pretty self-explanatory. And so what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to combine two things. What you already know with the info or the information found in the text. So I'm going to draw a double arrow there, because to make an inference, you're pulling these two things together, everything you find in the text, any pre-knowledge you have, and you're pulling that together to draw the conclusion. And generally, a conclusion should be obvious. If a writer does a good job in their writing, then the conclusion should be easily identifiable. Otherwise, you may draw a conclusion that is not the conclusion the writer had in mind. But nevertheless, it's important that you as the reader analyze the writing and identify the logical conclusion. A prediction is a guess about what will happen next. So when a reader actively engages in whatever they are reading, they naturally make predictions about what will happen next. And they base these predictions off of what they have read, and what they already know. So by taking what they have read and what they already know, a reader can formulate what they think will happen next in the story. So consider this sentence. Staring at the computer screen in shock, Kim blindly reached over for the brimming glass of water on the shelf to her side. So the reader is naturally going to read this and have an idea of what is going to happen next. And the reader will probably notice the word blindly. So Kim is so caught up in what's happening on the computer, she goes for a drink of water, but since she's caught up on what's going on the computer, she reaches over without really looking at the glass of water to grab it. So the reader is going to assume that she's going to knock over the glass of water. Now, that may not be what happens, but still, it's a prediction either way. A prediction may come true, and a prediction may not come true. But a reader is naturally going to make predictions about a passage, and making predictions is part of being actively engaged in what the reader is reading. Reading comprehension, fourth grade. When it comes to summarizing text, you need to be able to state the main point of a story. So a summary is just stating the main point of a story. So you're reading an entire story, and then you're just taking the important things and writing about that. If you've ever looked at the back of a book, you'll see a summary on the back of a book. And so there's a whole book that may be 100 or 200 pages, but the author summarizes it on the back of the book so that you get an idea of what it's about. So that's what you're trying to do through a summary. So there's four main points that you should remember when writing a summary. Focus, like I already said, on the main idea of the story. Focus on the key points. In other words, you're not worried about little details. You're worried about the important things that contribute to the overall storyline. The third point, focus on the conclusion of a story. Because in most stories, there's some kind of problem. The whole plot is based around some kind of problem throughout the story. Then eventually that problem is resolved. And so that happens in the conclusion of the story. So look at the conclusion of the story and talk about that too in your summary. So you're going to be talking about the main idea of the story, the key points, the problem, you know, maybe a little bit about the main character, and then talk about the end of the story and how the character ended up dealing with his or her problem. Then the fourth point is kind of a longer one. Focus on important information the author wants the reader to know. So throughout the story, you may notice certain points that the author really wants the reader to understand. And so look for that important information and conclude that in the summary as well. And so a summary is typically one paragraph in length. So it's not very long, because it does not need to be long, because you're not focusing on details, you're just focusing on the overall story. And so remember, again, you're looking for important information. And so we're not interested in details. Try not to even think about the details, just look for the main idea of the story. Now, in some cases, you might be writing a summary for a long story with multiple settings and scenes. And so a summary may be a few paragraphs in length, and these paragraphs give the main points of each major part of the story. And so the summary of a long story always includes a conclusion to wrap up the story as an entirety. So like I said, the summary is usually going to be one paragraph, but if it's a really long story that has lots of different settings, lots of different scenes, lots of different problems throughout the plot, you may need to write a paragraph for each main point or major part of the story. And then for that summary, you're going to write a few paragraphs, and then you're going to write a conclusion that's going to kind of summarize that whole story. And so only make a summary longer than one paragraph if you feel like you cannot include all the important information in one paragraph. So again, a summary states the main point of a story. Supporting details are very important parts of a paper. It can be said that the topic and main idea of a paper is the most important part. But without supporting details, main ideas and topics are irrelevant. So basically, supporting details reinforce a larger point. So a writer will make a point which may take the form of a topic or a main idea of a paper. So the writer makes that point, and then the writer backs up their point with supporting details. And these details are most often found in informative and persuasive text. And this makes sense because if the writer is telling you about something, each main point they make, they're also going to need to back up with more points so that the reader can be sure that they are being told accurate information. Then also in a persuasive text, if the writer is trying to get the reader to do something or to think a certain way, the writer can't just make a bunch of points. They're going to have to back up those points so that the reader will indeed think that way or take that action that the writer wants them to take. And supporting details are often easy to spot because the writer will let you know that those details are coming. A lot of times they'll make a main point and then they'll say something like first, and they'll make us give a supporting detail, and second, and give another supporting detail, and then say finally, and then give the third supporting detail. Or they might say something like for example or for instance, and that would tip you off that the next supporting detail is coming along. Supporting details need to be two things. They need to be both factual and relevant. Because if something is totally accurate and factual, but it's not relevant to the main idea, then it's no good. The supporting detail needs to be accurate and needs to relate back to the main idea. And if a supporting detail is very relevant, if it pertains to the main idea, but is not accurate, then again, it's no good, because what good is information that is not true? So the important thing to remember with supporting details is that basically their job is to reinforce a larger point, and they can be most often found in informative and persuasive texts. They're often easy to spot because they're preceded by words like first, second, finally, or for instance, or for example. And the most important thing for details to be is both factual and relevant. Reading comprehension, 7th grade. In some circumstances, it's important to be able to synthesize text. So what we're going to do is we're going to read this story, and then we're going to work on synthesizing or paraphrasing it. So we'll get to that in a minute, but first let's read this story. So Emmanuel went swimming in the lake by his house, where the water reached a depth of 20 feet in the middle. He did not venture out more than 6 feet into the water, however. So now we want to paraphrase this, which means stating the author's ideas in the reader's own words. So what we're doing here is kind of like a summary. And in fact, you may have already thought, oh, that sounds just like summarizing. But it's a little bit different, because a summary typically involves including the main points of a longer text, such as a novel or full story. Well, this is not a full story, and it's definitely not a novel. It's just a couple sentences. So when you paraphrase, you're taking a couple sentences or an entire paragraph, and you're including the main point of the text being reviewed, because that's what the reader needs to know about the text. So in this example up here, the reader needs to know that Emmanuel went swimming in the lake, but not more than 6 feet out. Those are the important points. It's not really important that the reader understands that the water reaches a depth of 20 feet. So we want to focus on the main points here to kind of summarize it, but in other words, just take a couple sentences and state it in our own words. And so in this case, a good paraphrase would be Emmanuel went swimming 6 feet out in the lake by his house. Emmanuel went swimming 6 feet out in the lake by his house. So that's a paraphrase of this up here. We're just taking the main points, taking those points and expressing them in our own words. And so this right here incorporates the main points that the audience needs to know. ACT English strategy. A text is said to be engaged in the rhetorical strategy of persuasion when it attempts to convince the reader of a certain fact or opinion through the use of reasoning. So the rhetorical strategy of persuasion is when the writer is trying to convince the reader through the use of reasoning. Now, there's a couple of criteria that an essay needs to meet in order to be an effective persuasive essay. So a writer needs to make sure they incorporate these two criteria into any persuasive essay they're writing. So the first one is an effective persuasive essay is somewhat objective. In addition to that, an effective persuasive essay favors one side of the argument. Now, you may be thinking that these are contradictory statements, but these two statements can coexist in an essay. Now, the reason a writer needs to be somewhat objective is that a persuasive essay that does not seriously and reasonably assess the arguments of the other side will not be able to convince an impartial and thoughtful reader. So that's why it's important to be somewhat objective. The essay can't be overly weighted to one side. The writer or the reader needs to feel that the writer weighed both sides of the argument and that they're giving facts from both sides of the argument. Now, in order to be a persuasive essay, however, the essay cannot be totally objective. It has to favor one side of the argument. Now, an informational essay could be totally objective, but in order to be a persuasive essay, the writer does need to favor one side of the argument. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with the writer trying to push one side of the argument. It's just important that they're objective enough that they get some trust with the reader. Now, because the writer is trying to persuade the reader, it's very important in persuasive essays that the reader take care to separate matters of fact from matters of opinion. And so you're probably already familiar with this concept. A matter of fact would be, he was born in 1953. Now, a matter of opinion is, he was a nice man. So these are really very elementary examples of matters of fact and matters of opinion. But notice here, he was born in 1953 as a fact. This is undisputable. But he was a nice man is disputable. People have different ideas of what nice means, and they have a different idea of whether or not this person was a nice man. So it's important that you as a reader are distinguishing between the matters of fact that the writer uses and the matters of opinion that the writer uses, so that you as a reader are not being deceived by the writer.